गुरुर्ब्रह्मा गुरुर्विष्णुः गुरुर्देवो महेश्वरः गुरुः साक्षात् परं ब्रह्म तस्मै श्री गुरवे नमः तस्मै श्री गुरवे नमः तस्मै श्री गुरवे नमः ईश्वरो गुरुरात्मेति मूर्तिभेदविभागिने व्योमवद्व्याप्तदेहाय दक्षिणामूर्तये नमः अवर प्रोस्ट्रेशन्स टू दक्षिणामूर्ति हू इज द गुरु हू इज द गॉड एंड हू इज द सेल्फ ऑल रोल्ड इनटू वन एंड वी आर नॉट अदर देन हिम इन अदर वर्ड्स ही अलोन इज एक्सप्रेसिंग थ्रू अस सो वी कंप्लीटेड वर्स नंबर 49 वेयर इट वॉज टोल्ड दैट Hence, for him that just knows the sacred lore, the belief that the world is real as such in its own sight does not cease. Who? For the ignorant one, for the seeker who is not subjective in his approach. When he looks around, because you cannot stop the senses from interacting with the world, you cannot stop the mind from thinking, but the one who is not well cooked, well baked, he continues to consider, I am thinking, what I see, hear, touch, feel, taste is real. But the one who is well baked, he doesn't give, he gives it as much importance as much as you give to your dream. That much importance. How much is that? Zilch. Zero. The moment you wake up, no question of going back to your wife or husband in the dream. Next day, new one. New children, new everyone, new God, new guru, everything new. New environment, new house, new clothes, new body. And that is the truth of the waking also. Deluded by this false belief, he ever wanders helplessly in samsara like all the rest. Whom are we talking about? The uncooked one, the unbaked one. You know, there was, you must have heard the great sages of Maharashtra, the four brothers and sisters, Jnaneshwar Maharaj, Nivrittinath, Saint Nivrittinath, Saint Jnaneshwar Maharaj, Saint Sopan Dev, and Saint Muktabai, their youngest sister. And one day, first time in their life, they went to Pandharpur, where Lord Vitthala is. And when they went there, they saw the God so much in love, they hugged. That is the only place where you can hug the statue. So you hug the statue, the Lord, and immediately at that very moment they hear some beautiful bhajans going on. So they go there and they find an elderly gentleman, like a grandfather, sitting there and singing and crying his eyes out in love for Lord Vitthala. Vitthala, 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 Jai Hari Vitthala, Jai. And he's going on. And the three brothers, they went around three times of that old man, great devotee of the Lord, touched his feet, stood up, and then the elder one said, hey Mukta, go and touch his feet. She looked at him, like you're looking at me right now. Looked at him. She says, unbaked. Young, 10 years old. She says, no. Because the thought that went through that old man, that old devotee, his devotion towards Lord was such that anyone comes with any problem, he will offer it to the Lord and Lord will come and solve that problem for him. We find it very wonderful, isn't it? But that is not realization. And she said, he's got ego in him. I'm not touching his feet. And they are both saying, you are the youngest, don't act like a child. When elders are doing it, you should also. She says, why should I? I will not. And she stood her ground. And afterwards, all the saints and sages during that time had come together in Pandharpur, and they all decided, let's go to Alandi where these four brothers and sisters stay. And they all come. And this elderly gentleman, he is also coaxed into coming there. And he never wants to go away from Vitthal statue. And he goes. And after every day he's thinking, why did I come here? I want to go back to my Vitthala. I want to go back to my Vitthala. And these other saints, they are thinking, he is so pure, he is so ready, he is so empty. But he doesn't have the knowledge of the self. What can we do to give him the knowledge? Because he's ready. All we have to do is light the fire. Put the spark in. Because he's ready. He thinks the divinity is only in Pandharpur in that statue. He's attached to the statue. He doesn't have the eye to see that divinity is all pervasive. For that knowledge is required. And then they are young. So they can't tell him. He is three times their age. So they find one of the, you have to do. He was a potter. Namdev Maharaj was a tailor by profession. They tell a potter, you are elderly. They hatched a plan to make him realize. See what saints do. So they hatched a plan. So he went. He's a potter. How do you know a pot is well baked? The sound should come properly. Solid sound should come. So he took a piece of wood and he hit on Nivrittinath's head. He didn't even flinch. He says, baked. Then went on Jnanadev Maharaj, baked. Went on Sopandev, baked. Went to Muktabai, young girl, 8, 10 years old, baked. Didn't flinch. Because body disidentification. Then went to Janabai, baked. Went to another Mahatma, baked. And Namdev Maharaj, what is this drama going on? Baked and unbaked and baked and unbaked. And he knows now his turn will come very soon. He's already unsettled. And he comes to him with a piece of wood. Katak! Oh, I'm an elderly person and for... You brought me here to, and this is how you respect an elderly person. This is how you respect, respect a guest whom you have invited, and that to a devotee of the Lord, all full of himself. Mm. And in that, it creates the drama. I don't want to stay here. I don't know why I listen to you, stupid fellows, and you may be saints, but I am happy with my Vitthala, and the. Gora Kumbhar, he didn't say that he's unbaked. That young girl, at that time, she says, unbaked, and laughs sarcastically, or out of compassion, whatever it was. And now that those words of that young girl have stuck in his mind, unbaked. And he crosses the river, rushes to Pandharpur, catches his feet and he says, why you allowed me to move away from you? This is, I can't live without you, this, that. And while he's crying, bawling his eyes out and surrendering himself to the love of the Lord, at the back of the mind, unbaked, unbaked, unbaked. And he becomes aware of that unbaked. And he says, she said, while he's there, he had free entry. Because he's a saint. So that girl said, I'm unbaked. What do I have to do to show that I'm baked? And he gets up. Please give me an answer. Show me a way. But he cannot accept that in front of anyone. Only in front of his beloved Lord. He gets up, turns around. Gora Kumbhar, who hit him with a stick, he's standing there. He says, you want to be baked? He says, yes. How do you know? He says, no, don't worry. How I know? But I am not your guru. Go there to that village. There is a temple. Go to that temple. You will find your guru there. Who is it? Tell me. No, you go. First he says, what, these fellows are again sending me somewhere away from Lord Vitthala. Again they'll do some experiment on me. Again I'll come back crying. I better not leave. But unbaked, unbaked, unbaked is going on in the back of his mind. And eventually it unsettled him and he goes. And when he reaches the temple, he finds one very sick person with leprosy, pus oozing out from all over the pores in the body, lying there with his feet on the Shivalinga. And the moment he enters, he stink of the leprosy, of the pus. Anyway, that Gora Kumbhare said, goes in, and the first thing is, where's this man? As he got eyes got adjusted to the light inside the closed temple, he found someone is sitting with his, lying down with his feet on Shivalinga. Blasphemy! Hey, don't you know? He says, I don't know, I don't know. I can't even lift my hand. I don't know how my feet came onto the Shivalinga. Is it wrong about you? I don't have energy even to turn. If you are so disturbed with my feet on the Shivalinga, please, if you help this poor man and help him by shifting his feet. Namdev in that. Take the feet, moves away. The Shivalinga moves under his feet again. Then he moves somewhere, again the Shivalinga moves. At that moment, Eureka! Suddenly he realizes, because he was ready, he realizes the knowledge takes place. Knowledge is not through words. In that instant, what we are articulating, that became his direct experience. See, we are only thinking, we are only talking. But you keep becoming available. Where, when, how, have faith, it will click. In this lifetime, it will click. It must click because it has got no choice. Because I'm working towards it, because I'm available to it. Every moment of my existence, I'm available to it. I can't even try and get away from it. It's impossible to get away from it. How can you get away from it? Tell me. Oh, you'll say, I can get away from it by thinking about the world. But the self is still there. Without the self, you cannot think. So, but this dialogue, this interaction, this intention within has to be continuous. The term used is Taila Dharavat, continuous stream of attention, not intermittent, continuous stream. You are listening to me intermittently, listening. One word comes, goes away, then second comes, then goes away, then third comes, then goes away. This is intermittent. But your vision on me, is it continuous or intermittent? No, you're blinking in between. So intermittent. It is intermittent. Continuous means your eyes must not blink. But your availability to yourself, you cannot deny yourself. Whether you are in waking, whether you are in dream, whether you are in sleep, you cannot deny yourself because you are always. Find that one which is always. Is the easy, nothing in this creation you can focus continuously, because either your attention will shift or that object will change, because nothing in this creation is continuous. But there is one place where if you put attention, direct realization of that continuous, and that is the conscious self, the Atman. That is the transcendental state. So, after having invoked our Kundalini to Sahasrara in the 49th verse, now we move into the next verse. So the deluded by this false belief ever wanders helplessly in samsara. As long as you are searching for the self objectively, through experience, through thought, through miracle, through some support, you are like a dog chasing his own tail. Will never be able to catch it. But that's the only way we know. Thoughts is the only way we can think. Think to go beyond thinking. So choose wisely what words you utilize to erupt in your mind. Choose wisely what thoughts you allow to manifest in your mind, which direction you take your mind to, because you have that choice. At this moment you have a choice to think. While listening to me, you have a choice to think about something in the world. And maybe at times other thoughts are coming, but you give them zero value and your attention is here. That's choice. You are exercising choice. So do that within yourself. Now in the 50th verse he says, Vagyantra tulyo yamudiryate cha. Vagyantra tulyo yamudiryate cha. Buddhvapi shastrardhavama shanta chetaha. Buddhvapi shastrardhavama shanta chetaha. Apanditadapyavaroya mukto. Apanditadapyavaroya mukto. Madadi doshai paribhuta bhavaha. Madadi doshai paribhuta bhavaha. It is said by Sri Bhagwan Raman Maharishi that the knower of the sacred lore, meaning the Vedas or the all the thoughts about the self, the knower of the sacred lore, whose mind has not subsided in peace of the supreme state, is just like a gramophone. He's talking about me. He's talking about me. Only speak. It is also said by Sri Bhagwan that he is even worse off than a man without learning, because unlike the latter, he is overwhelmed by moods of pride and so on. See? So what happens when we have not reached the destination, are only intellectualizing, then immediately, if someone says something, that is not it, I know what it is. Oh, there are three states. No, there are four states. No, I know it's I'm the witness. No, witness, no, you don't know. I have studied more. Do you know, have you read about this? Confuso Upanishad? No, I have not. No, see, you don't know. So, as much knowledge we collect, it only increases our ego. And what happens when we collect knowledge? What happened at the beginning of the last class? The chicken farm. The chicken farm. When the knowledge has been eaten, digested, and it has nourished you in the right manner, then, and if your attention is on what it is indicating, then there is no reaction for anything. There is no reaction within. There is no disturbance, because you are in the peace that is your essential nature. You are in that tranquil space. So here Bhagwan says, it is also said by Bhagwan that he is even worse off than a man without learning. Why? Worse off than a man without learning? A man without learning can be taught. A man with learning cannot be taught. very difficult to undo what he has already programmed his mind with. Very difficult to undo the mind of a person. He has already, I have studied this, I have studied that, I have gone to this teacher, I have gone to that teacher, I have done the Shankar Bhashya, I have done this, I have done this. It's very simple, man. But if you are already full of, I know this, before you open your mouth, the sentence is completed by the other. You are thinking of the shloka, the other prompts the shloka. He knows everything. He knows Bhagavad Gita by heart. He knows the scriptures. He knows the all the experiences of Buddha and Krishna and all saints or sages. But himself is empty. Mean, no experience. But knows about everything about what is not required. For such a person, very difficult. He is worse than an unlearned. Why unlearned? Unlearned mind has got no data. If I want to reprogram what I have to do, or if I want to my laptop is full, now what do I have to do? I have to reset. I have to empty all the data from my laptop or my phone. In an intellectual person, it is very difficult to empty it. But an unlearned person is already empty. No preformed ideas. He's open. Look at Nisargadatta Maharaj. Whole life he just sold cigarettes from a small shack. And one day he went to the satsang. Just once. And it clicked. Because he was available. No data. All he did was his duty. That's it. And what was his duty? My son is there, I have to educate him. My wife is there, I have to subsist somehow. So, this is the job I know. I am not educated. 8th standard fail or pass, whatever it was. And the day it clicked, intellectually it clicked, not experientially. He is not abiding in it. It clicked. And the teacher said, Tattvamasi, you are that. Same day he came back, told his son, leave your school, you have studied 3 years more than I did, take over the selling of cigarettes, one room apartment. In that one room, so there was one room and the other hall, one bedroom apartment, other hall, kitchen, toilet, bathroom and living space all together, and another room, bedroom. Locked himself up in the room. 2 years later, master came out. Only worked on one thing. The words of his teacher. You are that. You are that. What did he say? I am that. What does it mean that I am that? And he just went on. Went on. See? And it took 2 years. Ramana Maharishi, 18 years, but we say 18 because he was discovered after 18 years. But he must have come to know long time before. See? So it's said, a sincere and wide awake aspirant may even bewail the barrenness of the result of his theoretical knowledge, saying, oh, the illiterate ones are better off than I am. Such lamentations abound in the writing of the saint, one of the Mahatmas in Tamil Nadu. Indeed, as shown below, the theoretical conviction is only belief. It is not knowledge. So, theoretical conviction is only a belief in those words. That's all. But it's not direct experience. We need direct experience. So this is not told to judge Ramana Maharishi. It is not told to judge anyone. It is to see within yourself whether you are intellectualizing what you are hearing, or are you abiding in the self at this moment. बोधं परोक्षं तमिमं वदन्ति परोक्ष आत्मा तु न कर्हिचित् स्यात् नित्यापरोक्षस्य परोक्षबोधो बोधो यथार्थो भविता कथं नु दिस थियोरेटिकल नॉलेज इज स्टाइल्ड इन्फरेंशियल नॉलेज एज ऑफ अ थिंग एब्सेंट बट द सेल्फ इज नेवर एब्सेंट हाउ कैन इन्फरेंशियल नॉलेज बी वन दैट इज एवर प्रेजेंट बी ट्रू नॉलेज सेल्फ रियलाइजेशन अबाइडेंस इन द सेल्फ इज नॉट थ्रू थॉट्स इज नॉट थ्रू लॉजिक इज नॉट थ्रू एजम्पशन एंड इट्स नॉट थ्रू इन्फरेंस ऑल्सो All means of knowledge are taken away from you. Artificial means, second-hand means. Direct mean is left, but all second-hand means are taken away. If I see a smoke, yesterday we could see smoke, so we know somewhere there was fire. So because I am having ecstasy, so do I believe I am realized? No. No. There is no inference in the realm of the self. Those things happen, but that is not the conclusion. Many people stop once they start getting ecstasy. See? So here he's saying theoretical knowledge, inferential knowledge, logical knowledge, all these are incomplete. They cannot lead you to the self. Logicians distinguish knowledge as either direct or inferential, the former pertaining to objects perceived by the senses and latter to objects not so perceived by but only inferred. But for the reason stated in this verse, there can be only direct experiential knowledge of the self. Direct. That is called aparoksha anubhuti. Direct. And hence, the self is never a subject matter of inference. It is not because of that I know myself. Because my teacher said, you are realized, so I am realized. Because I had this experience, so I am realized. Because I have clarity of thinking, so I am realized. Because my mind was empty, so I am realized. No. You can have empty mind, but you can be unrealized also. There's no reason that can be attributed to realization. It's independent, it's self-existing. There's nothing like it. And therefore, the famous verse, this statement, which we spoke, I keep repeating it many times. It's caught my imagination. I think, therefore I am, or I am, therefore thinking happens.
I am, therefore thinking happens. I am, therefore.
But what do we think? I'm losing my memory. So which means I'm going out of existence. No. I am having dementia. I am having Alzheimer's. So, hey, fantastic. Why? Nature is taking care. You are not ready to reduce your thoughts. Nature is making sure that thoughts are reduced. Think. It's a blessing. Nothing to be complained. Now, don't take medicine for that. Be like a child then. Like it's the world's problem to take care of you, not yours. Take the advantage. Masters are also like that. They are childlike. A child is totally at abandonment, no? Everything is to be done by everyone. Yesterday when we were playing with the kid, that kid came to this table, grandfather is more concerned that he should not hit the edge of the table. Isn't it? That child has got no care, no concern. He is only in the moment. Other people are caring. Why? He has got no memories. He has got no data. You also become one with no data. Trust, the world will take care. Like our Papa Ramdas, when he was married, he had a son, and he decided, he was doing contemplating, and he decided that today is the day, enough of life, family life. And he says, I am going to live at the mercy of the Lord, the same God, I am going to live at his mercy. And the moment he was about to get out of the house, in the middle of the night or early in the morning, whatever time it was, the father said, his father, now that you are going, take this mantra, it will protect you. Om Shri Ram, Jai Ram, Jai Jai Ram. He said, God, I have not even stepped outside, you are already taking care of me. 9 years he lived without ever worrying about where the food is going to come from, where the accommodation is going to come from. One day he was traveling in the train. Must have sat somewhere, someone must have put him, went in. Sannyasis are allowed free, not nowadays. But the TC came, ticket checker, he came, he said, where are you going? Where's your ticket? I don't have ticket. The ticket checker, in the 2 o'clock in the morning, pulled the chain of the train, stopped the train, called the police, disembarked him. And the police came in a jeep, took this fellow, or Papa Ramdas, took him to jail, locked him up in a cell, gave him food to eat. He says, Bhagwan, Ram, what grace. There I was lying on the floor in the train with no food, no water, no bed. You created all this situation, you got me a bed, a room. And next morning when the sub-inspector came, he looked at him. He says, Baba, we are sorry that this constable has done this to you. Where do you want to go? He says, where do you want me to go? You buy me ticket for wherever you want me to go. And he bought him a ticket. He says, please take some money. He says, no, I don't want any money. He says, then take some bananas. He says, okay, give me one and no, he says, you take 10. He says, I'll have to carry. You send someone to carry it. He took 4 or 5 of them. That also he distributed to someone, kept one for himself, ate, finished. Empty. Minimalism. See, this is living with abandonment, where you totally trust the creation to take care of you. For that, courage is required. For that, courage comes when you have unflinching faith. Unflinching faith. In what? You trust the infinite. You trust the grace. You trust the self. And when that happens, there is no question of you not knowing it. So here he says that, yes, the self shines by his own light of consciousness and not by any other light. Na tatra suryo bhati na chandra tarakam. So it is self-luminous. Sun is self-luminous. But who is illuminating the sun? You straight away want to go to self. I'm asking a simple question. Everything is not about self. Who is illuminating the sun? The moon? So who is illuminating the moon? The sun. Who is illuminating the sun? Our eyes. Without eyes you cannot see sun. Who is illuminating the eyes?
Mind.
Mind. Who is illuminating the mind, meaning the thoughts?
Consciousness.
The consciousness. And who is illuminating the consciousness?
Yourself.
Consciousness is self-illumined. Don't keep asking questions. You have to stop somewhere. Otherwise that story will be like you are in a room with many mirrors and you sit in, you are stretched in all directions, no end. It's not like that. Consciousness is self-illumined. Also, knowledge by sense perceptions is not really direct, that is, immediate, but only through a medium, a sense organ, that is a sense organ. The self being consciousness needs no medium. We are also seeing, we must have heard Swamiji's lectures, we are seeing the world with our eyes, but how do we see the world? It creates a form, inverted form in our retina. Inverted, but you are seeing everything straight. Silly. So, but how is that? But you studied physics or whatever when we long many can't remember the whole thing, but it was always an inverted picture is created, isn't it? So in your eyes also inverted picture is created, but you are seeing the world straight. So either you are upside down or the world is upside down. See? And you cannot see the world without eyes. You cannot hear the world without ears. You cannot think without the mind. But the self knows itself without a thought. Therefore, it is self-illumined. It is its own light. The sun, now take that example away, that sun is illumined by our eyes. The sun is not borrowing any light from anywhere to illuminate. It's illumined by its own light. Yeah, in other words, self-illumined. Exactly the same way. The self, the consciousness that we are, is self-illumined. It doesn't require any medium. It doesn't require any support. Continuing in the 52nd verse, Dehoham asmityanu bhuti rupo. Dehoham asmityanu bhuti rupo. Bhavatya bodha khalu bandha hetuhu. Bhavatya bodha khalu bandha hetuhu. Bodhohamasmiti vena nubhutim. Dohamasmiti vena nubhutim. Katham vraje nashamado bodha esha. Katham vraje nashamabodha esha. The ignorance causing bondage is just the experience through mistaken of the form I am the body. How can such ignorance come to an end except by the awareness I am the pure consciousness? If we are addicted to thinking and we cannot, at this present moment, I cannot not think. Nature has not started its process yet of making me forget. If I can't, and you are told that you have to dissolve all the thoughts, and the thoughts are not dissolving, what do you do then? So you are a gone case. There's no hope. There's no possibility of realization. But you said you are already realized. Then is there no possibility of quietening the mind, which is turbulent? There is, and here the solution is. Mind is, see, if the problem is in the body, if the problem is in the body, where will I find a solution for it? Within the body, isn't it? If the problem is in the mind, then I have to find a solution at the mind level, not at the body level. So if the problem is at the thought level, then you have to counteract with another thought. Simple. And that is what is being told here. And what is that? That if the problem has begun with I am the body thought, and that is where we are, then we have to counteract it with something which can dissolve that default position. And what is that? I am the pure consciousness. That's all. You had I am the bachelor thought. Then you have to dissolve I am the bachelor thought by thinking I am the wife thought. Or I am the mother thought. Simple. That's what this is, a methodology which you have been employing throughout your life. I look at here, I am the son. I look at her, I am the son. I look at someone, I am the teacher. I have to immediately dissolve that role to take on the new role, isn't it? I have to contract. But if I am the son, and here also I am the son, and here I am the son, then how will I teach? Or how will I perform all my roles in life? Impossible. So you know how to dissolve. Do you say, no, but I need spirituality to become, change from mother to wife? It's very difficult. Mother doesn't leave me. How do I invoke the mother in wife in me? Or the and you go to work and you continue to be mother and you forget that you are an employee.
Disaster.
But, and you see, there are cases. A person has had a fight at home and he comes to the office and someone says, sir, I need a half day leave. Why? My wife is pregnant. I have to take her to the hospital. All wives are same. No leave for you. Why? He's still carrying the wife. He must have had some fight in the morning. He didn't drop. So the reaction. Think. So you know how to drop the previous role and take the next one. Apply that ability. That ability came at the thought level only, no? When you say, I am the mother or I am the wife, it's only at a thought level. Nothing has changed. You are still the same. Exactly the same way. I am identified, drop it or replace it with I am the pure consciousness. And accept it, believe it with faith. Insist initially. Insist. Just like you are insisting that you are the body or you are whatever role you are playing, every time you insist, oh, but this is so difficult, you are insisting. Why can't you insist that it is I am pure consciousness? Then there is a possibility of abidance, of merging. So I am the pure consciousness. Illusory experience can cease only by illusion-free experience. So what is illusory experience? That which is changing. That changing experience can only stop persecuting us when we have the changeless experience. And what is the changeless? The self. Abide in it, be it, accept it. Finalize. Don't postpone it. Nisargadatt Maharaj did not postpone it. Satya Sai Baba, today is his birthday. He did not postpone it. Nyandev Maharaj, he did not postpone it. All saints and sages, they did not postpone it. They took the bull by the horn and crushed. Bull is the ego. And you crush the ego only by getting nailed to the cross. Then alone resurrection will happen. And the resurrection is of the pure self. The identified self gets crucified and the pure self emerges. Pure self comes up. Choice is yours. You want to remain in pain? No, no. little bit nail here, little bit nail there, little, meaning little bit sadhana here, little bit sadhana. But why it is not happening? Because you didn't drive the nail through. You are taking it, you want to be individual also, and you want to sacrifice also. You are not ready to go all out. Because you are worried about the consequences. And the consequences, I will lose everything in this waking that I worked so hard for, like the dream. No, it's good to continue spirituality, but I don't want to lose this. Is there a way? No. Is par ya us par? This, my, this way or the highway? yeah, next one. धिया धृतोयम् हि परोक्ष बोधो धृतोयम् हि परोक्ष बोधो न धी प्रचारोऽस्ति तु सत्स्वरूपे सत्स्वरूपे दैत्यं यथा पुण्यजनं वदन्ति पुण्यजनं वदन्ति वदन्त्य बोधं बत बोधनाम्ना. This theoretical knowledge is only intellectual, but the intellect has no access to the real self. Convictions, all convictions are only at thought level. That's all. Intellect has got no entry into the divine realm. Not possible. Even though grace is flowing all the time, intellect cannot get in touch with that grace. It can get in touch with expression of that grace in tidbits, which we call ecstasy, which we call joy, which we call temporary joy, peace, happiness, tranquil, etc., etc., but not permanent one. No access to the real self. Just as evil spirits are ironically styled as good people to the ignorance, so this ignorance is styled as knowledge. Just like evil spirits are termed as good people. Why? You know why spirits are called as good people? Because there are many master, many tantrics and etc. They can control spirits, and they can make anything manifest. Anything, if they want to change the situation, they can change the situation. But because, and that's what we are. We go to psychics. I mean, we means I'm not included in that. We go to psychics. I've been to many, many years ago. I was kacha.
Unbaked.
So we go to psychics, we go to tantrics, we go to see those who have some extraordinary power compared to us. We get attracted to if things are manifested. We get attracted to if someone is healing someone, or if someone is able to read our mind. Oh, I think he's a great master. And then very quickly 10 years go in that person's service till you realize everything that you owned is gone. Then I was taken for a ride. I will never believe in any master like this. And then you go to next one. He also loots you. Because you didn't fix this. You are still considering the sparkles of siddhis as a realization. And anyone who has a siddhi will use you to attain whatever he or she wants. So don't get sucked into anything of this. Not with other people, not with your own mind also. Because mind, as you grow, as you come closer, your mind is the womb from where all the powers will start manifesting. People will tell you, Swamiji, you touched me and my problem went away. Swamiji, one person came, I don't know, I can't understand still, but one person came and she said, can I come? I was conducting a retreat about 10 years ago, 10, 11 years ago. So I said, okay, come, attend the class, have lunch, and then if that's serious, you want to, urgently you want to talk. She came. And she had lunch and everything. After lunch, she took me to the side. We were in the hills, in Hillsville. And she said, Swamiji, I just had a miscarriage. Will I have another baby or not? I looked at her. I said, yes, you will have. She says, no, you bless me. So at that moment, I don't know what happened. I just touched her womb. She had twins. After that, she didn't come to me only. Now, I'm not saying that my touch did it, but it's a mystery to me also. She was so close. She used to call me for bhiksha, and we had to have, you know, the head tete-a-tete. But suddenly after the twins, didn't want to know me anymore. We don't want any more blessings. I don't know what else even. No, she stopped. These things happen. Why they happen? It's divine providence. Not because this was only a medium. It happens. And see, this I see in my life. I went to Maharashtra and someone's marriage was there, and they said, you have to come with us. And they bought me a ticket and I went to Bombay. And from then, after marriage, they have to go to their family deity somewhere in Maharashtra. They went there. He was there, the gentleman was there, his wife was there, the son who was getting married. I didn't know him, but his wife I knew, the girl who got married. So she called me. And I went there, and then his cousin was there, and we reached the temple, and I had just completed my Bhagavat in Melbourne, and the topic that I had completed was the Narasimha Avatar, Prahlad. And the day I was taking, I was in the zone, and I was roaring away in that story as it was happening. And when the Narasimha Avatar, Lord in the form of half man, half lion, he kills the demon, and I was in all drama, I was doing it. At that time, in that big house, the door by itself opened. Boom! And the wind rushed inside. And everyone, oh, what happened? I said, kuch nahi. The Lord has come in anyway. Anyway, after that, I go to this temple in Maharashtra, and that is the only temple where there is a, this is a Narasimha temple. I didn't know where I'm going. And this is the temple where Prahlada's statue is found, because on the banks of the river, he did his tapasya, his austerity. And I was after, and the, we went into the temple, the priest was doing all this, and he never tells the story. He told us the whole story of the Prahlada and everything. And after that, it was so blissful, right on the top of a hillock. I was sitting outside against a pillar, and then this boy's father came, Swamiji, then said, Swamiji, do one favor on this young nephew of mine. I said, what happened? He said, he's married for 3-4 years and he's not getting any child. So I said, I can't get married. What can I do about it? The Lord is there, go to him. You ask him. No. Then what can I do? I have to somehow push them away. So I said, okay, give me one fruit, I'll give it to him. Just casually. I give two fruits, probably if he keeps, I'll give fruits here also. Doesn't mean that you're going to get pregnant. That will be a worry. And within 9 months, the father comes and tells me, Swamiji, your Ashirwad worked. I said, what? I don't know. So many people I've given fruits to. He said, no, you gave that fruit and you said you will have a baby, and he had it. It's a mystery. I don't know how, where, when, what happened, what is the process, why that blessing worked, why that blessing doesn't work somewhere else, why it worked. It's not about the person who's giving blessing. It's about the availability of the person. So same way, the Paramatma, the pure consciousness is ever available. Ever available. Grace is ever available. Are we open? Are we available to it? Or we have switched our phone off and then we are saying, why the signal is coming, I don't know. Not coming, I don't know. Put the phone on. Switch it on. So what is switching your phone on? I am pure consciousness. What is putting the switch off? I am the body consciousness. Switch on, I am the pure consciousness. Repeat again and again. Then the grace will flow. It has got no choice. Because grace is ever available. Grace is ever available to everyone all the time. Because grace is not other than the self. Where are we? There, this one, huh? This theoretical knowledge is only intellectual, but the intellect has no access to the real self. Just as evil spirits are ironically styled as good people, so this ignorance is styled as knowledge. So here what he's talking about? The thought knowledge is termed as knowledge. I'm reading the verses, I'm reading the commentary by Lakshman Shastri, and on that I'm expanding. Everything is happening by way of thought. This is not knowledge. This is equal to the spirits being taken as divine, as good people. In Sanskrit literature, the term good people is used ironically to designate evil spirits, the asuras and rakshasas. Who are these people? Asuras, rakshasas and demons? Those who are extroverted. They are the ones. Rakshasas are material oriented. Asuras are whatever is mine, whatever is yours is also mine. That is asura. Asuras are people who cannot see a happy person. They have to create trouble, which we also have done. So we were also asuras sometimes. Child is nicely sleeping, snoring away or deep in sleep. Hey, wake up. Why? Let's go to play. Asura. This is asuric vritti. Doesn't allow you to sit in peace, to be contented. It will come and trouble you. No, I'm doing it for his own good. Laziness is next to devilness. So I'm waking up. But you are asur. Let him sleep.
Yadarka tapto mrugatrushnikayam. Mrugatrushnikayam. Snatva narastapa vimukti meti. Annam pachet chitragata. Ninava Nampa Chetagnava Paroksha Bodhena Tadas to Mukti.
When a man scorched by the sun becomes cooled by bathing in a mirage, or when one succeeds in cooking food on a painting of fire, then one may attain deliverance by theoretical knowledge. If, in other words, if you are trying to realize the self through thoughts, it is like cooling yourself in mirage waters. It is like cooking on a painting of fire. All this is told to inculcate vairagya. Don't be too much addicted to listening. Don't be too much, even though Shankaracharya says shravanam mananam nididhyasanam. Actively listen, then reflect and contemplate and merge. Yes, but the process, the background of that is, while you are listening, if you are not listened properly, then you have to reflect. If you are not reflected properly, then you have to contemplate. Or the other way around. If you are not contemplated properly, you have to reflect. If you are not reflected properly, then you have to listen. But if you listen properly, the other two further steps, they are absolute. Because while listening, as I have told you in the first lecture, while listening, if you are there, story over. You have fallen back into yourself. Without doing anything. Because you allowed every word. Mind is perceiving the word, let it. But your attention is not on the word. Your attention is on what that word is and indicating, not seeing, indicating. So the word, tumhara naam kya hai?
Amita.
Ah, word Amita is indicating her. Isn't it? So when we say the word self, what is it indicating? Is it just a word in your mouth? Is it just a word in your mind? Thought in your mind? Or it has a some other possibility? It's indicating something. Our attention must be on that. What's the time?
Time is
3:11.
3:10.
Oh, okay. Ten, two more verses, then we stop. So, etch it into your mind, intellect. What? Coming to realize through words or thoughts, listening to thoughts, words, is equal to cooling yourself by taking a dip in the mirage waters or by cooking food in the painting of fire. So now, what will happen in the next class? I mean, you said that listening is not going to take us there. All of you will vanish. If you vanish out of realization, well and good. Well and good. I will be happy. See? This emphatically. Thus, emphatically, the notion that theoretical knowledge is checkmated, denounced. Thought knowledge is not equal to knowledge. From our understanding, knowledge is only one. And what is that? The self. It's not a second-hand knowledge. But majority of us, when we speak of it, we only speak of it from thought point of view. Tat swanu bhutya rahito dvayatvam. Rahito dvayatvam. Vachavadhan dvaiti samana eva. Vachavadhan dvaiti mana eva. Nagachato vang manase hiturryam. Nagachato vang manase hiturryam. Tatrasthitasyasti matam nakashchit. Tatrasthitasyasti matam nakashchit. Tatrasthitasyasti matam nakashchit. Therefore, one that talks Advaita without actual experience of that truth is just the same as the Dvaiti. Dvaiti means the one who accepts duality as reality. So, he who speaks of non-duality only through words, without having a direct experience of that non-dual self, he will be termed as a dual person only, lost in his mind. Neither speech nor mind has any access of the supreme state. Na vaak gacchati. Managacchati. So, truth is that where the speech cannot reach, and the truth is that where the mind cannot go. It cannot even enter into the sanctum sanctorum. Just like you came here, you left the chappals out, mind has to be, at least here you brought it in, they allowed you. In temples, you have to put it outside. You cannot take it in. No, it will get wet. Who cares? They will not allow you. So similarly, that which is dirty is not allowed in the sanctum sanctorum. What is dirty? Dualism is dirty. Where there is sense of otherness is dirt. Where there is acceptance of differences, that is dirt. Acceptance of dirt. That is not allowed in the sanctum sanctorium of the self. You have to leave it out. And therefore, where is duality? In the mind. Mind cannot enter the sanctum sanctorium of the self. Therefore, nava gacchati na mana gacchati. Doctrines more or less true are helps to the aspirant. They do not survive in the state of deliverance, that is illumination or realization. The sage does not know the self because he is the self. Subtle thing. He does not know the self. So when your question was, do you know? You have to. Valid question. I also asked. Or I never asked. I thought. I didn't dare ask that question. I will be fried alive.
You had a warm face, so that's why I was.
Yeah, I know. So, the sage does not know the self like I know you, like I know my body. A realized master doesn't know the self like I know the body. It's an objective knowledge. It's a thought knowledge. See, the rule is, if you catch it, you catch it. Every time I'll repeat it. Don't worry. Next year also we'll repeat it. And when I say it, you will not remember, but once, as I'm completing it, it will click. How do we experience the world? This is a person. I know this is a person. I am not the person. Isn't it? This is a camera. I know this is a camera. I am not the camera. This is a carpet. I know this is a carpet. I am not the carpet. Existence and consciousness together. This is how you cognize the entire experience in this world, isn't it? Whether it is space, air, fire, water, earth, past, future, thoughts, convictions, ideas, everything. Now, I see the body. I know the body. The rule should be the same. I am not the body. But here what happens? I am the body. Rule changes. With the entire world, there is one rule. With this body, a different rule. The same rule must follow. I see the body, I know the body, I am not the body. I see this body, I know the body, I am not this body. I see the breath, I know the breath, I am not the breath. I perceive the thoughts, I know the thoughts are coming and going, I am not the thoughts. But something goes amiss here when it comes to this. I see the body, I know the body, I am the body. Then fear. This body should not go out of existence. I see the breath, I experience the breath, I know the breath, I cannot live without the bread. I'm getting asthma, I think.
Ownership is there.
And go further. I see the thoughts, I know the thoughts. I think I'm losing my thoughts. This conclusion doesn't come when you go to sleep. You're losing your thoughts that time also, at a greater rate than in the waking state. Very quickly your mind gets empty, but you don't have the fear of losing thoughts. Why? Because you know you are entering into bliss. Why don't you have the same interaction with yourself in the waking? That mind is losing memory. I am entering into bliss. Conscious bliss. Not ignorant bliss. Conscious bliss. It's your reality is only what your convictions are. Understand this. We are all living in the same city called Sydney, or living in the same house. Everyone will have their own take of the environment that they are living in, isn't it? Even though it's the same house. What is making that difference? Your convictions. So what do you have conviction about yourself? I am the body, or I am the pure consciousness? They do not survive in the state of deliverance. The sage does not know the self because he is the self. This equation of him that has only theoretical knowledge with the Dvaiti is justified as follows. The dualist, what they say to justify themselves. We'll see this one and conclude. Advaiti na swan ganayanta ahuhu. Advaiti na swan ganayanta ahuhu. Jagan mrusha dukkhamayam jadam cha.
Jagan mrusha dukkhamayam jadam cha.
Atonyathaivetya pare vadanti.
Atonyathaive
pare vadanti. Phale tu sarvepi sama bhavanti.
Phale tu sarvepi sama
bhavanti. Those that think of themselves as Advaiti, that we are following Vedanta, we are Vedantis, we are pursuing the path of knowledge, they are fooling themselves. Because Vedanta is not a path, it's the destination. It is the natural state of yours. So what path you will follow where? Those that think of themselves as Advaitis, non-dual, say from intellectual conviction alone that the world is unreal, miserable and inert, unconscious. Others professing Dvaitism say otherwise, but in the result all are alike because both are having a verbal diarrhea, both are having intellectual diarrhea. They need to be given diarrhea tablets. Because if you are only talking about it, unbaked. That is all are in bondage and suffer the evils of samsara. They all act as if the world were real. So whether a non-dualist is talking about non-dualism without directly experiencing it, or a dualist is taking the world to be real and talking about it and complaining about the sufferings, the miseries thereof. Both are in the same category. Both are worldly. Om Purnamada Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi. हरिः ॐ श्री गुरुभ्यो नमः हरिः ॐ जस्ट सिट क्वाइटली आई डोंट नो द सेल्फ बिकॉज आई एम द सेल्फ कॉन्टेम्पलेट ऑन दैट